This is TWiT.
There's been tons of theories whipping around about this ever since the day that Neil and Buzz first set foot on the moon. And if you look at the surveys and the studies on this, I believe, depending on the time period you're talking about, and not all that recently, something like 72% of the Russian public does not believe that America landed on the moon, which at one time or another was a belief that may have been fostered by a certain amount of propaganda from their government, although not at the moment it happened, I don't think, as I recall. And oddly, in Asia, the belief is quite high. So the numbers of doubters are down in single digits in some Asian countries. In the UK, Tariq, for some reason, it's about 52%.
Wait, why are you calling me out for that? I live in New Jersey.
So. I just wanted to make the point, Tariq, that I mean, half is
I feel attacked. Bizarre. So.
Yeah, no, I just found it very puzzling. I sort of thought, oh, my brethren from you know, centuries gone by, that's where my family came from. How can you disbelieve?
So the conspiracy theory is that we never landed on the moon, that it was all fake. Right. Like shot on a set somewhere. And then there's lots of different claims, right? There's no stars in the background. Are we going to talk about that stuff?
But let's not forget that not only was it shot on a soundstage, but it was, of course, directed by Stanley Kubrick.
Who, there was, I mean, 2001 came out about the same time, right?
1968, which was very convincing. And Kubrick supposedly made a deathbed confession at one point. There was supposedly videotape of somebody who looked in the shadows vaguely like Kubrick lying there gasping for air saying, yeah, I done it. And I mean, you know, it wouldn't take a whole lot in shadows for me to look like Stanley Kubrick in his last days. So there are a lot of ways to fake that, but, and especially now, of course, but this was, you know, pre-AI, so it was probably makeup and so forth. And as Tariq said, there's those are the claims. Now let's look at some of the evidence people cite.
Well, we should say all the claims though first. Like I only mentioned like a couple of them. Like, number one, it was shot on a soundstage. Number two was that there's no stars in the images or the video on the moon.
Right.
So that's the other one. Number three is that the flag was waving, right? Like it was a day, like a windy day on the moon. Or are there other claims from that? We've got.
Let's see. I can see wires has been cited. And, you know, a lot of this is sadly supported by there's been a series of documentaries in Britain, and our very own Fox Network in the U.S. has produced more schlock about this and alien encounters and all that I can even begin to recall. There were claims that it was too hard. Everybody knows you can't fly to the moon. And I have to admit, you know, having written a number of books about this, when I look back from today, I'm still sort of stunned that it worked, because when you look at the levels of tech, which are just crawling out of the 1950s when they started this program, you know, we were just coming off of vacuum tubes. But if you look closer at all this and go to the museums and go to NASA facilities and crawl around and look at the records and look at the hardware and everything, you know, it would take almost as much money to build and buy and pay for the conspiracy than it would to actually do it. So, I mean, you could push back and forth about that. Some of this started with a book in 1974 by a gent named Bill Kaysing, K-A-Y-S-I-N-G, who was a former Rocketdyne writer, not engineer, but a tech writer or a PR writer for them, and a former Navy officer. He wrote a book called We Never Went to the Moon, America's $30 Billion Swindle. Now, this is self-published in 1974. When you self-published, it was embarrassing. It's a little more acceptable today, but it was considered vanity publishing back then. So this began this industry of doubting. And the other bookend of that is, of course, our good friend, Dmitry Rogozin of the Russian space program, who claimed a number of things. And part of this is you can't fly through the Van Allen belts. They'll kill you. The things Tariq pointed out, reticle marks, the little etch crosses that you see on a lot of the moon pictures being behind objects. So clearly it was faked. Which turns out to be simply an illusion on the print due to exposure, which is the same thing about the stars, by the way. If you expose to get the foreground right in a fully lit moon, which has glass and metal in the soil and everything else, you're just not going to see stars. Anybody who's ever taken a picture knows that. And if Ant was here, we'd have him weigh in on that. But my favorite of the doubters is the rolling Coke bottle. Have you heard that one?
No, I haven't heard this one.
So some woman claimed that while she was watching a moonwalk, I forget which one, I think weirdly it might have been Apollo 12, which of course nobody watched because the camera burned out. But she claimed she saw a sight of a Coke bottle rolling across the surface of the moon while the astronaut was walking.
Wow.
And clearly, yeah. And then another more. There's no crater under the lunar module when it landed. Well, they shut off the engine about 10 feet above the surface and then mm-hmm. just dropped. And so on and so on. So, and then we have, of course, people like Bart Seibel, who's written a bunch of stuff about this and was famously punched out by Buzz Aldrin when he was mowing him. I think Buzz is on his way into a hotel.
Oh, yeah. You can Google it. You can see the clip on YouTube.
It's so great. I mean, this clown is following Buzz around holding a Bible. Put your hand on this Bible and swear you went to the moon. And poor Buzz, you know, he turns away from him 8 or 9 times and says, please leave me alone. And then finally, after begging this guy to go away, just decks him. It was such a beautiful moment. Anyway, sorry, that's a bit of an aside. But, I mean, what do you think, Tariq? How do we convince people?
I think
we were there because it took a lot. Now, I've got my evidence, but I want to hear yours.
It is a fun conspiracy theory to believe, right? Because it has all those Hollywood makings. In fact, there was a movie starring the guy that plays Ron Weasley, you know, where they have to, in fact, fake the moon landing. So there's like a whole movie just about that. There's a James Bond movie where they're chasing James Bond through like the set where they're actually filming the moonwalks.
Well, let's not forget Capricorn 1.
Yeah.
Which really set the high watermark for let's fake a space mission movies.
That's right. So I think that's part of it. I do feel that the separation between the 60s and 70s when the space race was actually like in full heat and the astronauts were walking on the moon, and now, which is like a generation or two have gone by, right? And everyone is separate now, and they have these devices. We have all this AI stuff where everything can be fake. We just saw that right now, you know? So I think that is probably one of the separation and the time, and then the changes in technology have made a whole new generation susceptible to not believing kind of established facts. I mean, we can talk about facts versus reality and people not accepting facts in science and stuff like that until the cows come home. And this could be, you know, part number one. But what I think that we'll see a lot of this change in the near future because, or people double down on it because NASA says they're like a few years away from actually landing people on the moon again with, you know, very similar technology. It's a little bit updated, but like the physics are the same for it. And if these like theorists are still chouting the same thing about the new stuff, that'll be very interesting to see too.
Because I was going
to
say, you know, NASA could go, they don't plan to, but they could land near a former Apollo site and stroll over there. And of course, there are a lot of people that'll say, oh, well, they just went back to the same studio and that's the old standing set. So I have to add, I think, you know, this is an interesting time period because when we talk about the first moon landing in 1969, this was very much the go-go jet set hippie lay 60s. And if you know people from that time period, or in my case, experienced it as a young man, there was a lot of mistrust of government and, quote, the man, unquote. Mm-hmm. Anything that's an authority figure was bound to get you in trouble and start land wars in Asia and so forth. And so I think some of this, at least the intensity of it, I think, may be leveraged by the fact that there was a lot of pushback on authority and on systems and on government. We didn't trust the government. We had just had the Vietnam debacle. We were coming up on the Richard Nixon years of increased mistrust of government. So I think that has something to do with it. And I've talked about this on the show before, but when I'm on shows like Coast to Coast AM, which is a big, much larger audience than ours radio show that's on every night and deals with conspiracies and ghosts and paranormal and so forth, I enjoy doing the show. The second hour is call-ins, and there's always at least one or two that are kind of odd and that you know talk about the whole moon conspiracy thing. And I used to go in this big, long parable about, you know, well, okay, you know, go to the archives, look through the photos, look through the tapes, go to the museums, touch the rockets, blah, blah, blah. Of course, nowadays, if you touch the rockets, the security guards will come taser you. But, you know, look at this evidence, talk to the moonwalkers, look them in the eye and see if you think they're lying to you. And then I was thinking about it and I did some research. I was reading some papers. It's like, well, duh, you don't have to do that. Just look at the stuff that came out of the Soviet Union after the collapse in the early 90s. They were tracking everything we did up there. Mm-hmm. They had radar and were monitoring radio, and you can monitor the Doppler shift of radio and get some idea of where it's coming from and what speed the spacecraft is moving and all that. And certainly on the trip back to Earth, where they're moving as fast as 25,000 or so miles per hour, you know, you can tell that they're not sitting somewhere in Burbank faking it on a soundstage. You know, you could build an argument, oh, you know, these are tapes being played out of a spacecraft that was uncrewed. And to be fair to that body of thought, the Russians did fly, I think it was Zond 4 or Zond 5. They were doing a series of experimental shots to loop the moon before they were going to try and send their cosmonauts to the moon, which they never did. And at one point, NASA and or the CIA got pretty freaked out because we actually heard a taped voice coming from the spacecraft that had just looped the moon. Turned out it was taped. It was a tape recorder being played. The only live things on that spacecraft were, I think, two tortoises and some fruit flies. But we heard this voice coming from the spacecraft. It's like, oh my gosh, they've stolen our thunder. But there's just so much evidence.
Tortoises at the moon. You know, I'd watch that movie.
So. I have a whole chapter in Amazing Stories of Space Age about the turtle knots.
Tech Break is brought to you by ACI Learning. IT skills are outdated in about 18 months. Stay ahead of the curve and future-proof your business competitiveness with customizable, entertaining training. Fill out the form at go.acilearning.com/twit for more information on a free 2-week training trial for your team.